Hello, everyone. I just never thought I'd ever find myself in a situation like we are right now. Not me personally, any more than you are. I'm talking about our nation. My word, what a mess we are in, and what a situation. Of course, now the Lord actually forewarned us. He said that July was going to be something else, and said even August would be even more than what July that we're now facing in July. So we need to buckle up like we have never before buckled up. I mean, oh my goodness. I knew in my heart that there was something about to happen. God has just said too much and told about too many preparations that we need to be making and things that are on the horizon if we are truly living in the end of days, which, of course, I believe we are in the end of days. I think we're in the end of the end of days, and that Jesus really could return at any moment through the messages that he gives, through what we witness on television, what we read about. And of course, you know, you can't believe half of what you even hear on social media by any means, or even on television, because the government is totally and completely controlling almost everything that comes out to us. So we have to have discernment, as I keep saying week after week. We have to have discernment to understand what is going on. And I pray that the church will wake up and the church will, in these final hours, that we have the kind of freedom that we now have, that we will take advantage of it and we will pray like we've never before prayed, that we will have the power that God has given to the church, that we will activate that power, not only just personally as we learn how to let the healing powers of God flow through us. And again, I've been teaching on this for 40 years, and you can go back on, and I will direct you on every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. You can go, of course, to Whole Life Ministries, Sandra Kennedy Ministries, to the Healing Center, and you can see they're pulling up classics of mine of healing explosions that I taught, and we're getting absolutely phenomenal results from it. So I hope you will. I hope you'll go back, and I hope you will listen. All of us need to be refreshed about the teachings that Jesus gave about healing and what he has brought to us, what he's given to us. And we try to make that available to you as we go back through the years and what God has taught us and teaching us how to walk in healing, how to help each other. We need each other. We need to encourage each other. We need to help each other. The last thing in the world the church needs to be doing is criticizing each other and bashing each other. We need to be reaching out and helping each other. And as we narrow down to these end of days and we face things that we don't exactly even know what is on the horizon, other than that we are very well aware that things are changing faster than we can hardly keep up with. And that we know that as we come to the coming of the Lord, that as just as surely as the nations have turned against Israel and that they have turned against the Jews, not only, I mean, talking about nations all over the world, just like instantaneously begin to turn against the Jews. Do not be stupid enough to think that they aren't going to turn against Christians. And here in our own nation, of the things that we've done, God has been so merciful to us here in America. It's unbelievable. And with the assassination attempt that we had just a little better than a week ago, and we find ourselves, I know that Netanyahu's coming this week. We need to be praying for him. We just need to be praying for anyone and everyone who's in any kind of leadership, the protection of God, and that the wisdom of God will direct them and guide them. And as we, I wanted to share with you some prayer points that I'll be sharing at church tonight, but that we need to keep in front of us at all times. And that is, we need to pray that the decisions that are being made in reference to the Democratic convention that will be coming up very soon, it needs to be a cordial convention, even though at this moment it could be a free-for-all if things are not pulled together and people do not seek God and settle down. I mean, who knows? We can't automatically assume that the vice president will be the one that will be running for president. I mean, who knows at this point in time? Who knows? Who knows what is going on or what might or might not happen? Because at the moment, President Joe Biden, he is still the president. And so we don't need to jump ahead of things. We need to be praying and try to get in step with God And we need, above everything, to make sure that our lives are in step with God. We need to come to a place where we get any animosity out of our heart. We need to walk together in Christian love. We need to know what the Bible says about end times. We need to know what it is to forgive people, how it is to love and reach out to people, how it is, you know, we just need to know how to pray for people. So as I was saying, we need to pray for the Democratic Convention that's coming up, and we'll be praying more the closer it gets here, and we will pray the way the Lord teaches us to pray. And we need to be praying about this Secret Service. I've never seen such a charade in my whole life. As I witnessed, as I watched what's happening in Congress and all the questions and all the answers for Secret Service, one who's in charge up there, I just couldn't believe it. I could not believe what I was witnessing. I could not believe it. And, of course, we all have our own opinions, and I don't know that our own opinions matter too much. What really matters is what the Lord thinks about it. And the Lord wants us to pray that everything that is not of Him will be revealed, that things in darkness will come to the forefront. And God wants us to pray protection over those that are running in office, no matter what party they're in, but to pray security over our nation, simply because, in all honesty, our enemies are watching us. And there, you know, there's been many a prophecy. I spent most of the afternoon going over old prophecies as I dug back 20, 40, 50 years ago of prophecies of people that I know heard from God, and listening to them of what they prophesied. And I thought, oh dear God, I'm watching it come to pass. I'm literally hearing about it. I'm literally hearing and seeing it on the television, or witnessing it from every kind of angle, the prophecies that were given by outstanding men and women of God. I'm telling you, Deuteronomy was one of the most outstanding. I've talked about him. Brother Hagin, of course, who we honor so much. So many other prophets of God that gave outstanding words, that George Washington's prophecy. All these prophecies that have been given through the ages that are pointing to the time that you and I find ourselves living in. I mean, it's unbelievable. We do not need to be ignorant people. And our enemies are paying attention to our weakness. And so we need to be alert and tuned to what's going on. If ever we've been a sitting duck, this nation at this moment is a sitting duck. It's almost like, as I speak about this today, who in the world's in charge? I mean, I know that President Biden is in charge, but I know he's sick. I don't know exactly what's happening, and I don't think you do either. We need to pray for, as I said, for Netanyahu. We need to pray for the churches across America. We need to pray that the churches will come together, and that we will walk in integrity and respect, and that we will love each other. And as I started off, we don't need to attack each other. We need to love each other and reach out to each other. You know, yesterday on Sunday when I was teaching, I taught about avoiding Israel's mistakes. And there were five outstanding mistakes that Paul pointed out to us in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And I thought, oh, Lord, you are reading our mail. And the five mistakes that Israel made, well, they worldliness. They got caught up in the world, and they loved the things of the world. The church has moved into it too, that we're loving the things of the world more, in all honesty, than we are loving the things of God. We honor sometimes the people out in the world, or the people of this world, more than we honor the Lord Jesus Christ. We care about our own concerns and our own whatever more than we care about what the Bible teaches about things. Worldliness was a very bad mistake. And the Lord, all five of the mistakes that I'm going to read to you, the ending of all of them was death. I mean, a lot of people died as a result of these five things that we're talking about. Number two had to do with idolatry. That's putting things and people above Jesus. That's loving things, loving people, loving, you know, just yourself sometimes. Being caught up with you. Just caught up with your friends and your family and your business and your home and your money and the bank. More than you care about Jesus Christ. And that, the Lord says, is idolatry. And that we think idolatry is bringing out some kind of trinket and loving it and some old doll or something. Whatever. No, he named very clearly. And if I had time to flip back through my notes, I'd name them all to you and tell you all the things that he said that we had to be very careful of. I really want to read his definition of idolatry because, oh Lord, have mercy. Well, it will get your attention and it will get it really, really fast. You know, when it says here it is. An idol is anything or anyone more important to you than God. Anything that absorbs your heart and imagination more than God does. I don't know about you. I tell you the truth. I ended up just repenting. Oh, God, forgive me. I mean, just forgive me. On every single thing, I'm just, oh, God, forgive me. So we got worldliness. We've got idolatry. We've got immorality. Well, dear Lord, God, sexual immorality is just wild across this nation. I mean, it's just wild. It always has been. But it's wild in the church. I spent, 14 years, I think I told you this before, working for the government and working in mental health, in a mental health position, in a very high mental health position. And as I worked as a director of mental health, mental retardation, in an area, and for 14 years of it, I was stunned, and I've made this statement before, that when I came and began to pastor a church, which now I've been pastoring more than 40 years now, in our 41st year, and the things that I dealt with while I was in the world, in counseling and helping people, the church has the same identical problem as the world has, and it shouldn't be that way. Jesus has set us free. Jesus has helped us. He has put himself inside of us. We ought to be able to conquer some things we couldn't conquer before. So we've got a worldliness. We've got idolatry. We've got immorality. And then testing God. Oh, my goodness. And when the Lord gave the definition of testing him, I about fainted. Testing him, church, means to see how far you can push him. In other words, what can I get away with? How close to the line can I walk? How close to the world can I walk? How much can I play around in this arena? I mean, I know I shouldn't really fall all in it. I know God's against it. And I know the Bible is that, that as a Christian, I should be walking away from it. But instead of me walking away, I'm trying to see how close to the world I can get. And that's why the church is in as big a mess as the world is. And that's what he called testing him. Oh, dear God. I don't know anybody who hadn't. I mean, some of these, all of us have fallen into these arenas where we have just tested God. I got away with that. Nothing happened. He didn't do anything. Hey, I got past that. I mean, I think I'll push it a little further and see how much further I can go with it. It is not time to be playing games with God and thinking that he doesn't have a record of it, because he does. And of course, when you and I repent, the record is torn up. There is no record anymore. God, there's nothing in heaven that shows a record of our disobedience, or a record of our walking away from God, or a record of our just being the deepest of sinners. It's not there when you repent and you come to the Lord Jesus Christ and you let the power of the Holy Spirit push you and guide you and help you and help you conquer and overcome. God himself, through the power of the Holy Spirit, who is God, lives in us to help us be victorious in all those areas when I think, I don't think I can do this, Lord. I don't think I'm going to be able to conquer this. He says, we can do it together. I'll show you how. I'm in you to help you. The fifth one was complaining. Oh, Lord. I know. And, the Lord said, you know what complaining is? It's that, Lord, I'm not really satisfied with the way you have directed my life, or the way that my life seems to be going. I really think I could do it better myself. I almost passed out. I thought, golly, we have all done that. Complaining people. If you're a pastor of a church, you know a lot about complaining people. I mean, it's not an insignificant event. And complaining, I want to tell you right now, this is what, but see this church, complaining means you don't like what God is doing in your life. And you think you could handle your life better. And he said, well, you know, good luck with that. And every single one of these complaining people, you know, is if you all you're going to do is complain, if you don't have a solution, shut up. Just keep your mouth shut. But if you've got something, word of encouragement, or you think of a way that really might work better and you're willing to share it, and even if it's not accepted, you won't blow up like a toad, but you'll move over to the side and you'll, when people give me things and send me things and whatever, I look at them, I read them, and I take them to the Lord. And if the Lord says, and you know, sometimes I've said, man, that's a really good idea. And I just take it to the board or whoever, and I will say, y'all, I think this is a better idea. And we pray about it, and we get a leading and guidance from the Word of God because we want to do it God's way. Well, as I started this whole little thing here talking to you about, you know, making the mistakes that Israel makes, the Lord said, this is not time to make their mistakes. This is not time. But in every single one of these instances, which you, by the way, can go to Whole Life Ministries of Sandra Kennedy Ministries and pick up this past Sunday's message on July the 21st, and you will hear that full message as it goes in detail. You'll see that worldliness, idolatry, immorality, testing God, and complaining, every single one of those, the result was death came. Death came. Death came. People did not fulfill their destiny that God brought them here to do. They just got caught up in these things, and they never repented. There are many a person who has never repented. Many a person who thinks they're right. Many a person who says, I don't need God in my life. I don't need him now. I mean, we're doing pretty good. Things get bad, I'll yell at him, but I don't really need him now. I pray to God that's not your attitude. You got a God who knows you by name, and your name is written in the palm of his hand. He loves you. He has a destiny for you that only brings just wonderful things in your life. And he certainly isn't mad with you, no matter how far away you've walked away from him. He cares about you. He's still in the healing business. He still cares about your emotions, your physical body, everything about you, mentally, every area of you. The God in you brought enough healing powers and put it inside of you that we can draw from that and we can go forward with God if we'll just get ourselves out of the way. And again, he's just waiting for you to come to him. And any of these things I've named to you today, I hope you will repent and come to him. Please pray for our nation. There are going to be some trying days in front of us. And, you know, I'm just going to go ahead and say it. You hadn't seen anything yet. We've not seen the last of any of this. I promise you, if you think that you're saying, dear God, what is happening now? You're going to be saying it next week too. Dear God, what is happening? And you're going to be stunned. All I'm asking you to do is get your life ready to meet Jesus, because he could come at any moment. And he's coming to his church, to those who love him, to his disciples. He's coming to us. And he's about to come. And we have to be ready for whatever the world may throw at us. We need to be together. You need to be in a church somewhere. You need to be worshiping God. You need to be serving God. You need to have Christian people around you. And I hope you will find a church home. I hope you will be involved. And I hope you'll keep up, because I'm going to try to keep you abreast of what's happening, because there's a lot of things going on. And you won't see a lot of it out on the news, I promise you. But I'm telling you, there are some rough days in front of us, and you haven't seen anything yet. And remember this, things are not the way they appear, other than the Word of God, and you can take it to the bank. You say, well, that's not a good way to say it, because the banks may close. Hey, that's true. So you better hold on to that Bible and the Word of God. He's faithful, he loves you, and he's truthful. That's who he is. God bless.